Welcome, everyone. My name is Dave Schmittlein. I'm Dean of MIT's Sloan School of Management. And today we have a wonderful and special iLead speaker. As you can see, looking at the front of the room, we have a very nice fireside chat format for today's session. And so you know that John Chambers is going to be our featured participant. I think you all know that John is the executive chairman of the board for Cisco Systems. I'm going to take just a minute to say a few words about John. But before that, I'm going to say just a couple words about Hal Gregerson, who is going to be John's partner in this little gathering today. So Hal will be the fireside chatter, and John will be the fireside chat-e with respect to this activity. Many of you know Hal. Hal is the executive director of the MIT Leadership Center, and we were very, very fortunate a few years ago to be able to attract Hal to MIT. I won't do the long version of Hal's bio, but in at least 10 books that I know about, he is rightly seen as a leader in the way that innovative and disruptive leadership is pursued, including The Innovator's DNA, Mastering the Five Skills of Disruptive Innovators. I wanted to make sure I got that right, because you're writing it down. You're going to Amazon right after this session. And Hal, thank you very much for being a part of this community and a leader as in today. So let me say just a word about or two about John Chambers. I think you know, the executive chairman position carries with it some pretty interesting responsibilities. John is responsible for advice and counsel to the CEO. He's also been responsible and takes an active role in maintaining partnerships with important government leaders and business leaders on behalf of the organization. He's been involved in the ways that societies and governments improve digital access in countries around the world. And of course, his tenure as CEO, which stretched from 1995 to 2015, that 20-year stretch was just an extraordinary time of change, of course, but extraordinary success and leadership for Cisco Systems. So John started at Cisco in 1991 as Senior Vice President for Worldwide Sales and Operations. 4 years later, he was named CEO of the firm. At the time that John took over as CEO, it was a $1.2 billion firm. That was in 1995, so, you know, pretty large organization. In 2015, when he stepped down as CEO and continues as executive chair, instead of being $1.2 billion, it was a $47 billion organization. And no big surprise, John has been on just about every list of global CEO leaders, successful leaders, visionary leaders, and so on, including Time's 100 Most Influential People in the World. We are fortunate to have had John and continue to have John, I think of as a leader in the MIT community as well, because he's engaged with us in a number of ways on a number of important fronts. And I know that the president of MIT, Raphael Reif, and the rest of us in the community rely on John's insight as we go forward as well. So would you please give a very warm MIT Sloan School welcome to John Chambers. John.
Thank you. And thank you, John, for being here. We had an exceptionally well-scripted set of questions for today. And I'm going to sit them right there for the following reason. John and I spent a few minutes just before we started talking about what matters and what we'd like to talk about. And by the end of that conversation, it led to a set of questions that are the same, but we're just going to fly with it. Sound good, John?
Okay.
In the spirit of questioning, you've been around the block. What questions do you care about right now? What are the questions that are fueling the work that you're now engaged in?
Well, the first one is, whenever I speak to an audience, I try to put myself in your position and say, if you walk out of this session and you say there were one or two things that really make a difference in my future, then Hal and I have achieved our goals. In terms of personal interest, the world's going to go digital. Every company, every person, every car, every home, your body, going to be connected in ways you can hardly imagine. 500 billion devices, probably in 10 years, up from 17 billion, up from 1,000 when Cisco started. Completely transform every business model, every healthcare system. You're going to live longer, but going to have huge society disruptions. It's a period of you disrupt or you're going to get left behind. And that's tough, and there is no entitlement. Just because America led before doesn't mean we'll lead now. You all saw what happened with Boston 128 versus Silicon Valley. I was a part of it at Wang Laboratories. The second thing that's really important to me is equality. I think there is a chance with digital world, and probably Prime Minister Modi in India is leading the race, and it will shock you. The French have got their act together on startups, a socialistic government. The last place we'd go to do a business 4 years ago was France. Guess what was the number one country in Europe on venture capital investment? France. Changing. And it can be an inclusive change that occurs. The third thing is I love startups because Cisco grows wherever we acquire startups. They're like grandkids, of which I'm a grandparent. You can have fun with them. You give them sugar. You give them back to parents when their diaper's dirty, or you wound them up. But startups are fun to learn from. And if you're trying to create 25 to 30 million jobs in this country over this next decade, the big companies, unfortunately, are going to destroy jobs. So it's got to be a startup pace that is probably three times the number of IPOs we're seeing today on the market. And of course, that's just the tip of the iceberg. And then taking big, audacious challenges and saying, is now an inflection point in technology and markets and political will that suddenly you can change challenges such as 7 billion people benefiting from this, not a third of the population. Can you actually potentially bring peace in the Middle East through these changes that are occurring? I think that it can be done, and I think the window's going to be there in front of us. But in the end, my goal is for you all to walk out of this session and say, that was the best thing I attended at MIT in terms of key takeaways. And so that's our challenge for you and I to see, do we do that?
Well, good luck. So any one of those challenges, there are leaders involved in making a difference or not. Mm-hmm. And what kind of leadership skills or capabilities matter most to take on any one of those challenges?
Yeah, it's a great question, because if I were in your position, whether you have the ambition and the craziness to want to be a CEO, or you just say, I just want to do a good job in whichever job that I end up in, the characteristics are similar, and then I'll expand it all the way to government leaders, and I'll comment about who I admire most within that. If you watch what is occurring on it, you, as a successful leader, what I look for, whether it's a startup or I get to call on almost every CEO in the world or government leader the same way, is they are really good at vision and strategy, and they own that. The second thing they do well is develop, recruit, retain, and change their leadership team. The third thing they do is they build strong cultures. And when I became CEO 22 years ago, I didn't understand how important culture was. I kind of did it just intuitively. But boy, after a couple of years, I realized you never have a great company, regardless of size, without unbelievably strong cultures. And the fourth element that is really, I think, new in the last decade is you've got to be world-class at communications. Before, you didn't have to be. You could be at a company and that you could not even communicate with the financial markets, and you could run the company from your offices, et cetera. Those days are gone forever. Your ability to communicate, and what's the most important part of communications? Listening. And how do you do that in this new world in different ways? So those are common characteristics. What great CEOs do, or even great global leaders do, is they outline an audacious vision. They then say, what can really happen to achieve that? And let's use Modi as an example in India. India used to be the last place you would bet in terms of slow following the rest of the world. Modi, 2.5 years ago, outlined a vision and strategy for his country. He's taken it all digital. He's going to implement that vision and strategy for 1.3 billion people. He's putting his states in competition with each other. He articulates and owns what that means in terms of digital manufacturing, how he's going to change education, how he's going to bring broadband at $2.40 per month to every citizen in his country, what that means toward healthcare, how does he get his startups going, what does he do on security, partnered with a key partner to do this on a national basis, i.e. Cisco, which normally no large country would ever even think about doing. And he drove that all the way through his country. And instead of thinking, isn't it great to grow your GDP at 5 to 7% at a time that no other country, probably including China, are even going to grow 6, he thinks he can grow 7 to 10, and he's right. In his key states with 40 to 70 million people, he believes, and he will do it, barring a huge surprise, will grow in the 12 to 15% range. That means you double the per capita income every 6 to 7 years. A whole different way of thinking. France, which is, again, the last place you would think to do business. And all of a sudden you have a socialistic leader follow almost the playbook that Clinton did here. And I'm a Republican, bear with me on that, a moderate Republican, endangered species. But what Clinton outlined...
But you're sitting on my left.
Yeah, I am. I am. It's probably the only thing I'm going to be on your left on. But I was on stage with President Clinton right before I became CEO at Cisco at the White House. I was scared to death. But he was outlining the internet era. And he brought me in as the key business speaker for what this is going to do. And what he did, he was constantly curious and learning. He outlined a vision of what can be done. He said, John, do you really think this can occur? And I said, absolutely. No one in the room got what he was saying. The internet era could change America's position forever. It could dramatically change the incomes of the majority of Americans. And it could result in dramatically higher GDP growth than anybody envisioned. 8 years later, you know the numbers. 34% growth in GDP, over 4% per year. 22.5 million jobs. Don't we wish those days were here? Average median income up 24%. So what you're suddenly seeing is an ability of technology to play at a whole different level. But unlike the prior changes, which occurred over a decade, these changes will be over in 3 to 5 years. And you either disrupt or you get left behind. You're either Silicon Valley or you're 128. That's the challenge in front of us. Same thing for your companies. Majority of startups, 80% of them will fail. Majority of large companies, and GM and Ford know this, if they don't change, they will be irrelevant in a decade. And their competitors are no longer BMW and Toyota. Who are they? Google, Facebook, Microsoft, Uber, different asset sharing models. Where's the profits going to be? Chinese startups, a Tesla. And so those are the kind of things that, as you can tell, get me excited. And I think there's a chance to change the world with this.
So if you're in that role, or if someone sitting in this room is in that role of trying to change the world, and they're trying, I'm going to go back to what you were just talking about, which is basically trying to see disruption before it disrupts you, trying to see things other people don't see. If I were to look at your everyday schedule, or Modi's schedule, because he sounds like he does some of the same things, but let's talk about you for a moment. If I were to look at your everyday schedule, what things do you actively do to help you see things other people don't see? And in the end, it helps you keep from getting blindsided with those frightening unknown unknowns that really can do disastrous work.
It's actually your last comment that causes me to do this. I came out of a state called West Virginia that we were the chemical center of the world. We had more millionaires in West Virginia than the whole United Kingdom had. Great education system, per capita income is very good, and we missed transitions, and now we're number 48 or 49. Still very proud of my state, real challenge. I was part of Wang Laboratories. 32,000 jobs disappeared. Dr. Wang, most brilliant man I've ever met in my life, invented magnetic core memory. I apologize, he went to the school across the river. But he invented zeros and ones walking across the Harvard Quad. I have realized that when you miss transitions, the number of high-tech companies, around 128, used to be 1,000. Today it's one left. You get left behind. And so figuring out how do you get ahead of that and how do you identify where they go. There's only one Steve Jobs, and I knew him very well. He just seemed to have brilliance. And by the way, it took him 8 years to get there, but brilliance on what to do next. For us mere mortals, you've got to listen very carefully to the right organizations or structures, and they will tell you what to do. Every acquisition we've done at Cisco, I've done 180 of them. Two-thirds of ours succeeded, 90% of our peers failed. So we created an innovation replicatable model for it. But almost all of them we did by listening to customers and a Ford telling you fast Ethernet to the edge of the network ahead of ATM. And the courage, when they said fast Ethernet, I said, I beg your pardon, what does fast Ethernet do? And as a leader, you've got to have the courage when somebody tells you something, you've got to say, I don't know, can you explain it to me? And Ford explained to me and why they thought ATM, which all the top engineers in the world were sure going to win to the desktop. 2 weeks later, I'm at Boeing, and they said, you know, John, ATM to the desktop may not be as far along as we thought. And I said, I agree. It's going to be fast Ethernet. Can you give me the order? And they said, no, you got to go buy this company. I bought a company for $92 million that was only having $10 million in revenue. Stock went down that next day. Guess how much we generate in fast Ethernet switching revenue today? $13 billion at 65% gross margins. Listen to customers. They will tell you who to buy. They will tell you what trends. If you don't hear it until it's already about to hit the market, you got to go out and acquire the company. If you hear it with time, a year or two ahead of an inflection point, that's when you want to move. So I think you've got to listen. And maybe that's partially your sales background. The first thing you learn in sales is your customers will tell you what they want solved if you just take time to listen.
Did Steve Jobs ask good questions?
Not until the end of his career. Steve was a tough guy. Yeah. I liked him, a good friend. Steve was command and control, very much almost a cult type of beginning. Then he changed and he started to focus on culture. But even the culture, he knew where he was going and was very tough on people challenging that. Mm. At the end, however, he got unbelievably good also at listening and focusing on bigger issues in society and transitions. And I watched him one night with President Obama. We were at John Doerr's house, one of the top venture capitalists' house, and Steve was just so good on his advice and candor. Really, really good on it.
Thank you for that honesty around that. A bit of a probe into your own space and your
sure.
history. You know, there, mm-hmm. there's an arc of Steve Jobs, and I would agree with you. You know, he was different at the end than at the even the beginning and midpoint.
But he was the best at building products for the consumer ever in our industry. I mean, regardless of how he got there, he was unbelievable. Mm-hmm. Unbelievable.
And I think part of what made him good at that, at least from my perspective, is that he really did know how to probe. He knew how to ask questions, and sometimes people were uncomfortable about it, but he was probing for information.
Yes.
And, you know, as a salesperson, you're doing that. I guess the question becomes, in your work, through the arc of your own career, curiosity, questioning, asking the right questions, what role has that played in your success or failure?
I've had both.
And I'm nowhere near a perfect leader, and something that may surprise you, I think good leaders... You read about how they're a product of successes, right? Really good leaders are a product of how they handle their setbacks and their failures. And when you all have kids, how many of you have kids? When you have kids, it isn't how they handle their successes that as a parent you worry about. It's how they handle their setbacks. And once they learn how to do that, you can deal with almost anything that comes at you. I had two parents who were doctors. My mom broke a bunch of the gender barriers. And she'd be 90 years old if she was still with us today on athletics and academics across valedictorian of almost every class she was ever in. I got lucky on that. And she did psychiatry and internal medicine, and she taught me how to connect with people. And my entire career, I've never raised my voice. Now, make no mistake about it, I have unbelievably high expectations of my team. And I wish I could tell you I'm a good loser. I don't believe in losing. We are tough at Cisco, and we win, and we've never been beat on a large scale. And that's part of our culture and our direction. My dad, for a doctor who were notoriously bad business people, was really good at business. And he would see the trends coming and the logical extension. He combined the universities and the hospitals in West Virginia, was always focused, and he taught me to think 10 and 15 years out and to play out the cards. So between the two of them, it was tremendously helpful. A product of some of the challenges, I was dyslexic. And it will shock you, but probably 20 to 25% of the CEOs in America are dyslexic. Most of them will not talk about it. But as a dyslexic, you tend to read backwards, you have trouble reading sequence, so I give no speeches. Everything I do, I get an outline in my head and just talk to it, regardless of how important it is. But if I hadn't had a spatial teacher in the third, fourth, and fifth grade who helped me understand the weaknesses of this and how to make it a strength, I wouldn't have had the good fortune to get ahead. Now, having said that, My parents also taught me that we're all equal in life, but you can out-execute just about anybody if you're willing to really think about it differently, if you combine the emotional IQ with the raw IQ on it, and if you listen the right way. Mm-hmm. And so I have no fear. I love really complex, big challenges in terms of the approach.
One of the questions we chatted briefly about before related is, when was the last time you were dead wrong about something?
Well, this isn't fair because...
That's facing the fears.
Yeah. Hal has the list of 10 questions. I read his article ahead of time because I knew I was going to get asked one of them. And we were over here to the side, and out of the 9 of the 10 questions, I said, I nailed all 9 of them. That 10th question I went back to again and again, which was, when were you last dead wrong? And I was having trouble with saying when. And by definition, that meant I was already dead wrong. And so the one that I missed on that, being very candid, we've done 180 acquisitions under my scenario, and 20 of those were over $1 billion acquisition, but I acquired a company called Flip, and some of you might have seen the Flip camcorder. It was awesome, and it was so cool, and it was the most effective, and you could get your recordings, and you could put it up and Flipshare in the cloud, etc. And I let my team fall in love with the device rather than the sustainable differentiation. Now, this sounds simple, but it's the most important thing to remember in business. What is your short-term, intermediate, and long-term differentiation? If you haven't got it, you're not going to be in business. And Steve Jobs got up on the stage, and he held up the Flip camcorder, and he said, this is amazing technology. My team goes, see? I go, oh, no. And then he said, I'm going to give you this for free. It won't be as good at the start, but it's going to be for free. And I paid $600 million for the company. And we were growing at 100% year over year. What do you think I did? I folded the company. He outmaneuvered me, and he had me. My mistake? I was dead wrong in letting my team focus on the product. We should have focused on video into the cloud, because we already had the set-tops in your home, the video entertainment into your home. My view was the camcorder was going to be the next logical where you created your own video. But if I'd taken it straight and made our profits purely in the capability to move this into the cloud capability, and then moved the camera capability to every smartphone, I would have executed Steve. And he's really good, but he had me. And that's one of the other things to realize in business, that when you get outmaneuvered, you've got to either self-correct quickly, or you've got to just can it and move forward. And I know that 1 out of 3 of my acquisitions will fail, and I said that to the public, but guess what I get beat up on? Every time they talk about our M&A strategy, they beat me up on Flip. And I go, give me a break. It didn't even make it in my top 20 acquisitions. The same year I did a $2.1 billion acquisition that was successful, a $2.7 acquisition that was successful. And they go, why'd you fail on Flip? And so you've got to realize that as a leader, you're always going to get challenged more from your mistakes, where you're dead wrong or otherwise. And that's just life. And you've got to learn how you just deal with that and move on it. The one thing that does bother me is when somebody criticizes ethics, or are you doing things for not the right reasons. I'm not perfect, and I have no intention of being, but I try to always do the right thing ethically. And we're a pretty good company on that. We've won every corporate social responsibility award there is to win in the world, from Democrats and Republicans in this country and around the world. And so, I mean, one of the lessons, if you ever have doubts about what to do, determine what your North Stars are. I believe cultures of companies determine your success or not. Our culture, the first one is make innovation happen. Second is treat others with respect on it. And the fifth one is just do the right thing. And when you have that built into your culture, it keeps you out of the most trouble. It doesn't mean that I won't do something stupid. I occasionally will. And it doesn't mean that we won't make mistakes. We will. But when in doubt, just try to do the right thing.
What do you, or what does Cisco systematically, consciously do to help other people be like you just described, be ethical, be innovative, to do those things? You
know, gotcha.
How do you help others do that? Obviously, you do things yourself that help you do that, but the development.
Yeah, it's a really good question. Let me take the second part of the question first. How do we do this again and again at Cisco? What we do, and if you really look, if you would say, all right, John, let me take a full step back. What are your things that you do well? And we can cover next question if you want. What are my weaknesses? The things that I do pretty well, I get market transitions right. We see around corners, but we see around corners because we listen really well. And we know who to listen to. And then when we find something, we go out and are curious to ask more to find the right way to go on it. The second thing we do, we create a replicatable innovation process. And we are really good at this. We have 6 or 7 rules on acquisitions. We stick to it. We are like the Borg. We can absorb. We move at tremendous speed. And we develop those because when we first started doing acquisitions, the whole industry knew all of them failed. That's why our stock went down. But we get to the point now where our stock goes up when we do acquisitions, even when it's crazy in terms of the PE ratio or what we paid for a company because they assume we're going to be successful in terms of the direction on it. Even issues like giving back with network academies, we retrain 1 million students a year for where the jobs of the future will be, not the past. And it's the highest probably corporate social responsibility give back program in the world that has sustainability and been lasting for well over a decade on it. The average person who attends these gets probably 40% more salary. Most of them go on for advanced education. So it really makes a difference in terms of the direction. So that replicatable playbook, whether it's for acquisitions or whether it's become number one or number two, we are number one or number two, stole it from GE in every major product category we go into, 16 of 18 major ones, usually with over 40% market share. Key lesson on that, audacious goal forces you to think out of box, get a replicatable model, and move with speed. And once you set that goal, you had to learn to acquire, or you wouldn't be able to achieve the goals in terms of the direction as you move forward. In terms of the culture, you've got to walk the talk. Again, everybody makes mistakes. I just ask people not to make the same mistake twice. And when in doubt, I literally put on each of our badges our values and look at those and say, what do we want to do? The culture isn't different whether you're in China or India or the US or Canada or Germany. The cultures are the same in terms of what we do. And when in doubt, just think on that. There's no compromise on ethics or legality. On it. 80% of our product goes through channels. If you understand what that means in emerging countries, that can get you in a lot of trouble. We actually had a major review done by the Justice Department and the SEC on a whistleblower in Russia saying that we'd done something wrong. What we'd done wrong is we'd fired the person. But the issue was when they investigated everything we did for 4 years, we are the only company I'm aware of ever that at the end they didn't shake you down for an extra $20 million at the end and say, we'll give you a clean bill of health, with the exception they gave us a complete clean bill of health. That was all culture. It was a culture of just do the right thing. It was every time I'm in Russia saying there is no gray on ethics or doing things that aren't legal. It was firing one of the top channels, even though that top channel probably belonged to one of the top leaders in Russia's government. And when asked about it, I said, I lost trust in them. And they got it on it. So you have to tell the war stories. When you all walk out of this session today, you'll probably remember a couple key takeaway points, but you'll really remember the stories, how you personalize it, what really makes a difference. So as you communicate with your teams later in your business career or whatever career you decide, the ability to tie concepts back to stories are so important on how people will remember it.
So back to story, your world. Your development as a leader, what is one, maybe two, of the most profound, powerful, developmental experiences you've had as a leader becoming a leader? You know, those are those moments when we get pushed hard against the wall, when we learn something that matters, when my suspicion is it may well relate to some of the deep convictions you've shared around ethics and other things you've just talked about. Do any come to mind?
Two of them. The first one is one that I think many people in this room can identify with. At Wang Laboratories, I was the newest senior executive to the Wang Group. We'd become a little bit too inbred. Dr. Wang was the most ethical, greatest leader, smartest man I've ever met, as I alluded to earlier. And he trusted me. And I could not get him convinced that, because I'd seen what happened at IBM before I joined Wang, that we needed to move from being a mini computer company to a software and a PC company. And it's the only time he ever got mad at me, and his hand was shaking. And I should have pushed harder because he trusted me enough that he wouldn't have fired me. He would have listened, and he would have expected me to do that. I didn't push hard enough on it. When I went to Cisco, there was a huge discussion in 93 about did we combine with a peer company or did we do a small acquisition? And with the peer company, which my board really wanted to do, it was a merger among equals. And I felt that that was not going to work. In fact, one of my golden rules is you partner big to big, you acquire big to small. You never combine with a company that has a different culture, different set of values, different view toward the customers, different vision of how the market plays out. And it was hard. And I got pushed very hard, and I knew it could cost me the CEO role. But because of the experience that I had earlier in life, if it cost me the role, it just did. And I was very direct, and the board actually came back twice and started to overrule me twice, and I bet my job, and then I bet my whole senior management team job on it. Now, quick closing the story, obviously we did very well, and our competitors went ahead and merged, and they both crashed and burned. So conviction's there. The real painful one was 2001. And earlier, I got to know Jack Welch. And for each of you, I encourage you to get mentors that will give you advice. And one of the best ways to learn is to learn from others. And secondly, what's the best way to develop a relationship with somebody? Ask them to mentor you and give you advice. And take it one step at a time. But during the 90s, GE would come and they'd benchmark companies. If they found one good idea they liked, it was a very successful. When they came to Cisco, they went away with a dozen. And so we had a very close relationship with GE. And Jack at one point in time in 97, 98 said, John, you have a very good company. I said, all right, Jack, we're about to become the most valuable company in the world. What does it take to have a great company? He said, a near-death experience. Maybe you're getting old, Jack. I didn't say that, but I thought it. Boy, was he right. And 2000 hit, and we said it's a 100-year flood. I wish I hadn't used that word, but I'm always very transparent. And we said this is not unique to Cisco. It's going to kill the industry. And it doesn't help that we outperformed every one of our competitors. All, you know, their market cap was 3 times ours. They went to 1/3 of ours, but we went from a P.E. ratio of 205 to 8. And free fall would be an understatement. And I was getting the tar beat out of me, and you were very kind about the compliments. But I went from what some people might have said one of the best CEOs ever and could do nothing wrong to tell me again why we have you running this company. And it was brutal. And leadership is lonely. Shimon Peres taught me that, and I didn't understand it at first, but boy, I understood it then. And I was navigating through 2001, and Jack called me up one day. And he said, John, you now have a great company. I said, Jack, it doesn't feel like it. I'm getting that tar beat out of me. People have lost confidence in my leadership. People who I never thought would turn on me did turn on me. And boy, they did. I wish I was a better person. I never forgive. But I'll remember that. And we moved forward on it. And I said, Jack, it is just unbelievable how tough it is. And he said, this is your best year of leadership ever. He's probably the only person that ever told me that. And in hindsight, it probably was, because our peers crashed and burned. 25% of our customers didn't stop ordering. They just disappeared. We took $1 billion of just debt right down immediately. But it was my most development year, and it was the one where I did the best job of developing my own team about what it was like. But I would not be candid with the people in this room if I didn't say they were soul-searching, sitting out looking at the stars at night, wondering, is this right? Because I'm betting 70,000 people's jobs on this. We created 10,000 millionaires at Cisco. Never been done before, probably never again, out of the employee base. And all of a sudden, I was laying down my shareholders. And I was worried I had to do a layoff, which I never thought I'd have to do again in my life, laid off 18% of our headcount. And it isn't, again, that's just unbelievably painful. But for the people affected, you affect their lives forever. And it was soul-searching at that time. So, yes, you do go through this, and your leadership, when the team needs you the most, it's not during the good times. Anybody can be there. It's when they need you when things are bad. It's why every illness in the company I will track and will be there for our employees, their spouse, or their children that's life-threatening. And I spend, you know, often several hours every week on those type of situations.
One last question.
Sure.
I'll frame it and then ask it.
Okay.
So in 2015, a colleague here at MIT named David Brashears and I went to Everest, Mount Everest, to do a research project on what it means to lead at the edge of the possible. And I got really sick and made it to base camp, made it into the Kumbu Icefall, flew out, got home. In the morning after I came back here to Boston, the earthquake happened and the avalanche happened. And if I'd been there, I would have been dead.
Yeah.
Because our camp was one got hit. Comes back to the near-death moments, either
yes.
corporate or otherwise. And I left that realizing, you know, it really is important to build something that lasts, because we don't. And if I look at, you know, we had two grandkids last year, two new grandkids, and they're one-year-olds this year.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, if there were one thing, one skill, one value, that you could imbue or gift to those one-year-olds, the next generation of leaders for this world, what would that one thing be?
If I can expand it to two, it would be, I just wanted to be healthy and happy. As simple as it sounds, everything else is icing on the cake. And we've been through similar scenarios. I was on a flight out of Madison, Wisconsin to Milwaukee, startup Airlines Midwest Express, four airlines, got on it. The flight attendants were at the door. The pilots you could see were just out of the armed services, happy as could be. We sat down on the airline. I was flying with another Wang colleague. We took off. The young lady across the aisle from me was an unbelievably nervous flyer. I said, my wife is the same way. I gave her all the statistics about this. She said, any other suggestions? I said, yeah, I have a drink. And if she had the drink, she said, well, what should I worry about now? I said, it's a startup airline, so your pilots don't have quite as much experience. So if something happened, they might guess wrong. And as a startup, they might not do the maintenance as tightly. Milwaukee, for those of you who know the airport, you look down the runway, and you can see the plane take off. Three of us got off the plane, 17 people got on. It took off, blew an engine part, crashed right in front and killed everyone. So I realize our time here is very limited. I realize that you try to do what's right in life and you gotta be lucky. And sometimes being lucky is better than being good. But advice for all of you in business, the better prepared you are, the luckier you get. The harder you work, the luckier you get. We are always the best prepared in every situation as we can. So the third element I would add to my two grandkids, and my wife and I would drop anything to be with them. But it would be happy, healthy, and get a good education. Because if you have those, then everything else in life falls into place. Oh, last thing,
yes.
No fear. No fear. Because that allows you to think audaciously, and that's where you do great things. When you do things that everybody else believes is impossible. I really believe we can bring peace to the Middle East now more than ever through country digitization. At a time that when I even tell the leaders over there, they look at me like this. And yet I'm in Saudi Arabia and Egypt and Qatar and UAE and Jordan and Palestine and probably going to go to Turkey and saying, how do we use digitization to create a middle class and stability? Have no fear. Really go for it in life, and you'll be amazed that as long as you can figure out a truly differentiated path to get there, the success that you can achieve.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
So we're not done yet, but thank you. We have a few minutes for questions and a couple of suggestions around that. Try your best to make your questions brief so we can have more questions rather than fewer questions. And when you ask your question, you're going to have a mic. Make sure you talk into that mic so everyone in this room can hear. So please, questions for John. Over here in the front. Mic is coming. Thanks for waiting. I'm sure he can run. There we go. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, thank you so much for coming to speak with us today. You talked a bit about making sure that you have a short-term, middle-term, and long-term differentiation.
Yes.
And how that applies to product. Well, here, we're all part of MIT Sloan. How do we think about our own personal short-term, mid-term, and long-term differentiators, and how do we evolve that as we go on our own journeys to become leaders?
Yeah, and the answer to that actually is different than the business classes I went through. I've got an MBA and a JD degree, professional student, loved it 9.5 years. Great understanding spouse allowed me to do that. But when I would sit down at my schools, they'd say, look right, look left, and those people are going to be gone. And those days no longer apply. It is how you work collaboratively across groups and focus on outcomes that the future will be. The differentiation, even though this might surprise you, basic rule, treat people like you'd like to be treated yourself. I got the job at Cisco purely because of how I treated somebody 7 years before that I thought would never help me, but they were in a tough spot, I just helped them. And when I switched from Wang, because I did not believe I could interview for jobs at the time that I was laying off people, and I thought I would just leave Wang. I had a great resume, been very successful at everything I did. I sent out the resume and waited for the offers to come in. Very humbly, no offers came in. And 90 days later, I had 22 job offers in process. 21 were through friends, how I treated them. Differentiation, think creatively, think out of box. Shimon Peres taught me a lot, as you figured out. He's been my friend for 17 years and somebody the world will miss, and it's almost like a father to me. But every time we were together, I would ask him, what can I learn from him? And he would give me different approaches all the time. He taught me, as I said earlier, leadership is lonely. But he taught me to think like a teenager. Think exponentially. Your prior generation of leaders in your company, country, in school, thought linearly. 3 to 5% better, that's how you got ahead. Those days are gone forever. You got to Uber yourself, Amazon yourself in terms of the approach. You've got to think exponentially like a startup and then tie it together and do it with a great team. So what I look for, if several of you are running a business and you were to say, John, would you either get Cisco to invest? If not Cisco, would you invest? I'd look to see, do you really understand the industry you're in? Do you really have sustainable differentiation? Do you play well together with combining strengths? And do you have the confidence that you can connect with customers to get a differentiation product out? And so that would be kind of my thoughts and advice all the way down to depending on what your next job is.
In the back?
Now, you always worry when somebody's in the back, because when somebody's in the back, they may be just about ready to leave. They're going to ask a tough question. And this is a technique we learned over the years. Whenever you anticipate a tough question or you want to buy a little bit of time, you walk over and you get very close to the person. And you connect and you look in the eyes. And once you get this close, it's hard for them to be really tough on you. They also know you've got one arm on their shoulder, so they can't leave at that. So what is your question?
So you told us about how important a mentor was to learn. And I just wanted to know, in your organization, how did you choose your own mentor? And how do you know that this person can be a right mentor to you?
It's a great question. People assume a mentor is one person. You can have a really good advisor, and I encourage you to do so. And I think it's one of the most important things that people do on their development is to get people who will mentor and help coach them and develop them on that. But I think you actually want different mentors in different areas based on the experience. And so if you can develop that across multiple groups, there's some mentors that I have that are very old. Henry Kissinger, Wes Shimon Peres. My dad's the same age as both of those, 93. There are young mentors that I really care a lot about, Sheryl Sandberg. She teaches me about gender diversity and how important it is and how it isn't about women leaning in, it's about us men leaning in. You learn constantly from others, and the best way to develop that relationship is to have the courage to ask somebody, will you mentor me? But I'd probably ask for one session. Then if that go well, ask for another session and then others. That's what I did with HP at Lou Platt. I was coming out from here, Boston 128. I didn't know Silicon Valley. Called up the company. I'd managed 10,000 people here, but at Cisco, I was managing 450 people. And I said, Lou, would you spend a little bit of time teaching me about the Valley? I asked for one session. the end of the session, I did what any good salesperson did, asked for a second meeting, third meeting. Long story short, within a year, he was bringing three or four of his team. I was bringing three or four of my team. By the end of 3 years, Cisco was on a roll. I mean, and we did. We rocked it. And growth that nobody had ever seen before, and shared it, and tremendous, and no fear. And we were just beating up on the giants and loving it. I love to compete, in case you haven't figured that out. Most good leaders love to compete. But basically, at the end, I said, Lou, what can I do to help HP and give back? And I thought he was going to ask something very specific. You know what he asked me? Do it for the next generation of leaders, which is what I've always done. And so today I'm mentoring a number of people, new CEOs into big jobs, especially on gender basis, new CEOs and startups and investing in it, et cetera. So picking the mentors are very key. But don't ask somebody you don't respect, and realize that you probably, each mentor that you have will be able to provide different backgrounds. So Jack Welch did something, a Henry Kissinger did something else, President Clinton did something else, a Thomas Friedman out of the New York Times did something else. You're realizing that I have a lot of people that I learn from and hopefully give back to. But I like different ones on different topics. And it's a lot better to learn from somebody else's mistakes than it is for you to make the mistakes yourself.
Hi, thanks very much for sharing. I was impressed by one of the points that you mentioned about how there's no gray in ethics, and that was one of the points that you mentioned.
Exactly.
I would like to push back a little bit.
Sure.
I was wondering about experiences that you may have as a manager where you have to make decisions where I would say damn if you do and damn if you don't. Basically, there are two choices potentially, and each one would have significant costs on a different set of constituents.
Sure.
And so those are the situations when ethical codes that you may have as a professional may differ from your personal convictions or other convictions that you may have for different groups of people. If you could share a little bit on your experiences with that, if you had, and how do you come about making a decision that ultimately you may not be able to sleep very well, but knowing that you have to make a decision one way or the other.
Yeah, I have no problem sleeping well when I just do the right thing. It doesn't mean I always have, but just do the right thing. I can sleep well. And if somebody wants to come at me on my business strategy, I actually love it. And either I'll adjust it or we'll value. But don't compromise your ethics. And it always happens when damn if you do or damn if you don't, and this could cost me my career. It would have been so easy for me to say to the board of directors in 93, yeah, let's combine with this other company. I know you want to do that. You're going to let me be the head of the two. Instead, I said, I think this would be a fatal mistake. And you can imagine telling your chairman and your vice chairman that. If we do, I will not stay here to lead it. Because I'm not going to be part of something that hurts our shareholders and our customers. And so you've got to have the courage to stand up. And you will make mistakes in your career. And when you do, just admit it. And you move on from it. But it's when you get in those compromising positions. And the first one is never a right or wrong. It's gray. The next one's a little bit grayer. And then all of a sudden, you have both feet in the dark side. And you never come back. And so you've got to balance through that. I've only walked from two acquisitions in my career that I'd had the handshake with the CEO on. Both of them were on those issues. One was here in Boston with a company that we were going to buy, and the word leaked out that we were going to buy them, and I knew it was either from the CEO or from the investment banker. I wasn't sure which one. We were meeting here in Boston, and if they had just said, yeah, it did happen, and I said, it is out there in the market, I'm only going to pay this premium. I'm not going to pay the normal premium because the stock's already run up, and they did two things that really bothered me. The first was they said they didn't do it when I was pretty sure they did. And secondly, they said the market doesn't know about it. Give me a break. I know exactly what the market knows or doesn't know. And so we went back into the room. And even though it still would have been a good deal at the higher price because I lost trust in them, we came out and said, we're gone. Went and got in the airplane, flew back and bought one of their competitors in terms of the approach. The other time was one on where somebody had post-dated stock options in Silicon Valley, and I was going to buy the company. And by the way, I would have had no problem buying the company if they just told me. Because all I would have done is just gone to the SEC and said they made a mistake, person didn't benefit from it, and we'd have handled it. But because they weren't honest with me and I found out about it, and then their lawyer told me this isn't a big deal, and I went, this is huge, I walked from that one. And so again, you'll always have pressure on you, and most of the time you'll make the right decision. When you make the wrong decision, just go fix it, admit, and move on to it, on it. Does that make sense?
Thank you. We have perhaps time for maybe two questions.
So what Hal's doing very well is we always never say one question at the end. You always say a couple more questions because you want the right one to end on. So if the question next isn't one I can end on, I'm going to say, we need another question.
Yeah, don't end on this one.
No pressure.
Do
you know when you learn most about yourself and most about the members of your team? When they're under a lot of pressure. And all kidding aside, that's when you learn more about yourself, but it's also when you learn more about your team. And I put my team under pressure. I don't yell at them, but I absolutely like to put my team under pressure and see how they handle it. It's very telling, good and bad. Please.
So I hope the audience and my classmates will forgive me. I'm going to ask a very America-centric question.
Okay.
America-centric question.
Sure.
So I think that you spoke a lot about transitions, about missing specific transitions or catching them. I think few in this room would argue that America is in transition right now. We are potentially going to miss a critical transition, maybe already have. And I'd be curious, from your perspective, if you have advice for business leaders, and keep in mind we're rising business leaders, so a little lower on the totem pole, what we can do to make change and make this country come out in a positive space.
Gotcha. So some really politically loaded parts of the question. I'm not going to dodge the question at all. If you watch, I think we are at a turning point as a country. There is no entitlement as we go forward. Because we've been successful in the past doesn't mean we will in the future. And make no mistake about it, I've given that discussion in many speeches in Silicon Valley about 128 a year and how we missed it and how this could happen to Silicon Valley unless we change as well. On the national level, we're the only major country in the world that does not have a digital plan. The only major country in the world. And other countries will blow right by us. It won't be about emerging countries being fast followers. Emerging countries will leapfrog us in terms of the direction. France is the example in Europe. Everybody thought France was last place, and all of a sudden they jumped right in 2.5 years to first. We have to change. We've got to change our education system. That's what I worry about most, because we're not preparing your children for where the jobs will be. And we've got to get them in the 10 to 14-year-old basis, especially on diversity and gender. We're actually going to take a crack at that in France, interestingly enough. If it works, we're taking it to India. Then if it works, see if we can backdoor it in the U.S. Approach. And the universities have to change. And we had a really good discussion. The way that my generation was trained here at great schools is not where the future is. It's about how do you go across functional groups in universities. It's how do we stay ahead of our global competitors in terms of the direction. And at the national level, we're a nation of immigrants, and that should never change. One of the things that you've got to do as a CEO leader or as a chairman, you've got to decide how do you get the end results. And there are different opinions. Each company has to do their own in terms of what they think is important. I've only criticized government leaders in a major way one time, and that was over the NSA leakage with Snowden. And I wrote a letter to the president, and it ended up in papers around the world, and I knew it was, and it was high risk, but I had to do it. Had to do it for our company, and what was occurring was just wrong. Most of the time, I found it much more effective, regardless of form of government, to say there's a problem, and it makes you feel good when you sign a petition or you take a strong stand or you say something on CNBC. I found it to be much more effective, the old golden rule, praise in public, criticize in private, much better to say how do we work issues behind the scenes. That's what I've always done in China, Middle East, Russia, here in the U.S., et cetera, on it. So did that not dodge the questions okay and tell you where I stand? Do I think this country should lead? Oh, yes. Am I really concerned that we aren't moving fast enough and that we haven't got the number of startups going we need and we're not really fixing our education quick enough? Yes, I am very concerned.
I think we're going to finish on that.
Okay. Thank you all.
Is that we've done a lot of work at the Leadership Center over the last couple of years trying to understand what does it mean to be a leader coming out of MIT. And we don't have time to go into it, but there are three words that are the headline on it. It's problem-led leadership, where problems are that's the point. You're trying to solve problems. And from my perspective, at least today, I'm really grateful John's been here because that's the frame he's coming at, not only in the past, but as you look at these big problems in the future. Mm-hmm. It's problem-led leadership. It's not about you as a politician. It's not about you as a leader. It's about the problem. How can we solve it? And for that, you know, we're appreciative from the Leadership Center that that's the kind of leadership work you care about. So thank you.
Yep. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.